ओम शांति। गुड मॉर्निंग एंड वेलकम टू दिस थर्ड सेशन ऑन राजयोगा मेडिटेशन। टुडे वी विल टॉक अबाउट क्रिएटिंग सेल्फ अवेयरनेस, हाउ टू बिकम सेल्फ अवेयर। Now, what do you mean by self-awareness? First, let's understand that. Have you ever traveled by train? Yes, everybody has traveled by train. Now, when you travel by train, sometime in your life, you must have experienced that there is a train beside the train you are seated in. And that train starts to move. And you feel as if your train is moving. Yes? And for a long time, it's very difficult to discern which train is moving actually. And if you apply a lot of attention, then you're able to discern that actually your train is not moving, it's there where it is, and the train beside your train is moving, and this has created a feeling as if the train you are in is moving. So this is what it means, that when you, it is very difficult sometimes, you know, the feelings that we feel may look like appearing from somewhere else. Maybe you are feeling that the other train is moving, but actually your train is, yeah, maybe you feel that your train is moving, but actually the other one is moving. And it requires some amount of attention and awareness to recognize which one is moving. Similarly, when we talk about self-awareness, it has got something to do with recognizing that I am creating my thoughts and feelings. All through the day, while we are going through this day, we always tend to feel that my thoughts and feelings are being created by the one outside, whether it is the situation or the person in front of me. But if you create a little awareness, then you will be able to recognize and appreciate that actually your thoughts and feelings are your own creation. Let me give you a very simple example. Suppose somebody comes and tells you something. They tell you that your dress is not good enough, or they don't like your dress. Then what they just stated is a sentence, but how you play it in your mind determines how you feel about it. For example, when you take that sentence and play it in your mind saying, "Oh, that person said that my dress is not good enough, so that actually means I'm not good enough," then it will lead you to a feeling where you start feeling not good enough. Or if you take that statement and play in your mind, that person has such a bad sense of dressing that they don't like this dress, which is so good and so nice and pretty. So then it creates a feeling of ego in you, or you reject that person's opinion. Then the third scenario could be, you take that scene and tell yourself that person is entitled to his opinion, and they are giving their opinion about how they think about my dress, but that's got nothing to do with my dress or me. It's about their opinion. So then you create a feeling of respect and acceptance for their opinion, and you also don't create hurt inside. So there are so many ways in which we could take something that somebody is saying, or there are so many ways in which we could interpret a situation, and then how we feel about the situation is our own creation. Now it takes a little bit of awareness to recognize that how I am feeling is actually my creation. Because if we are not in awareness, then we will not understand. This is just about awareness, that we need to be aware to recognize and appreciate that how I am thinking and how I am feeling is my creation. It's not coming from outside. And if you go back to that example of that train moving, it is very similar. It takes a little bit of attention and focused attention to actually recognize this. And most of our life we live very unaware. So without this awareness or without this training of living our life in awareness, we have also always believed that how I am feeling and how I am thinking is coming from outside. But if you pay a little attention, then you understand that I am the one sitting inside, I am the soul, I have a mind, I have an intellect, buddhi, and the sanskar. And I am taking that information coming from outside, and according to my sanskar, according to my personality, I am converting it into an experience in my mind. So if you live your life in awareness, you will be able to recognize this subtle process whereby you are taking an information from outside and based on your personality processing it into a feeling. So this is awareness. Then, now this is one thing that I am aware about what I am doing inside. Second thing is about self-awareness. Now, if we want to understand self-awareness, a little story would help. There's a story which goes like this. There was once a hermit, a sadhu, and that sadhu was sitting on the bank of a river with his shishya. And there was a little ant who was trying to climb on a leaf and go across the water. So this ant tried to get onto the leaf every now and then, and whenever it tried doing so, it fell. It was unsuccessful in its attempt to get onto the leaf. So the sadhu was sitting there, and he every time the ant was unsuccessful in climbing to the leaf, he would help the ant get onto the leaf. And every time he would try to help, the ant would bite him. So there was his shishya sitting beside him, and the shishya was noticing that this whole process going on repeatedly. And then the shishya asked the guru, "Why don't you stop helping the ant? The ant is always biting you when you are trying to help it." So the sadhu said, "See, the ant is doing action which is in accordance with its nature. The nature of the ant is to bite. So the ant is very self-aware. So the ant knows what his nature is. So it's acting according to its nature. Now I am a sadhu. I am also very aware of my nature. My nature is to help. So if the ant, a small creature, doesn't forget its nature, how can I, the sadhu, forget my nature if I am faced with the nature of the ant?" So this is precisely what self-awareness means. If I forget my nature in the presence of somebody else's nature, or when I'm faced with somebody's behavior, then that means I'm not self-aware. My whole attention is on the other person's behavior, and I'm getting influenced by the other person's behavior. But if I'm very self-aware, that is, I conduct my life bearing in mind what my nature is. I go about my life keeping in my awareness my nature, my sanskar, my habits. Then the other person or the situation in front of me doesn't have power over me. Does this example come clear to you? Yes. Now, if I ask you one question, what is your nature? What is your nature? And when you answer this question, please answer it with this condition: what is your nature, come what may? Means it, what is that aspect of your nature which is never influenced by the behavior of the person in front of you or the situation in front of you? What I want you to come up with is one or two aspects of your nature which are always constant. That is, come what may, even if hell breaks loose, you always demonstrate that trait in your of your nature, in your behavior. Yes, Hanji Bhai sir, I can't hear you. Yes. I can't hear you. Why can't I hear you? Wait a second. Hanji, ab boli.
To help others.
To help others is your nature. Okay. Okay. Anybody else? Yes. Yes, let me know, sister.
I can logically analyze the situation very well, any situation that may be.
Okay.
And to act to the solution also, I take proper steps.
Okay.
A great extent.
Okay. Right. And when I ask you this question, did you consider the fact, come what may? Like helpful, are you helpful to everybody? Like somebody who cheated you, somebody who was not good to you, somebody who messed up your life big time, would you be helpful to that person?
Yes, yes.
Yes. So that's your nature. So then sister also shared that analyzing a situation based on logic and also finding the solution is her nature. So these are, so each one knows their own nature. So we must come up with something in ourselves which is a given in our personality or our nature. Even when we are faced with the most gross of circumstances and situations. So this is your nature. Now, people who couldn't come up with anything, now we have to understand that, okay, if even if we cling on to one aspect, that's a very nice quality to have, because it is said that if you have one quality, that quality will draw other qualities. Okay, so if you are helpful and you are helpful come what may, then you definitely will have tolerance. Then you will definitely be loveful because you can't hate and help. So if you have one quality, it will actually pull all other qualities. So this is the law. So if you, even if you consider one quality as your quality, it's a very good practice to have. Like if you think about being logical in every situation, then it's a very good quality to have, because then you can't be emotional. When you are logical, you can't be emotional. So when you can't be emotional, then you can't be affected by attachment or fear, or you can't be swayed by greed, or you can't be swayed by ego. So one quality will actually ensure every other quality. So this is a very beautiful practice to discern within yourself, what is my one quality? And if I have one quality which I consider to be my nature, then that one quality will sooner or later attract all other qualities in you. So congratulations to those who could come up with one point in their nature. And if we are not sure about my nature, then we will get pulled into other person's natures and the nature of the situation that we are confronted with. And if this happens, then this is a very difficult and a dangerous way to go about life, because then we are very vulnerable, very susceptible to my environment and to my circumstances. Now, if I have not created an awareness about what is my nature, then whenever something happens outside, I will tend to react to it. And when I tend to react to it, then my thinking will become my feeling, my attitude, my action, and then again, my habit. So if I don't ensure my habits, I will pick on other person's energies and create habits which will not help me in the long run. So this is the phenomena that we need to understand. Now, when we talk about self-awareness, yesterday we understood that I am a soul, I am not a body, and I am a soul which has a mind, a buddhi, and a sanskar, right? So I think, I create feelings, the buddhi can discern, decide. The buddhi has many functions. I will share some functions of the buddhi today. Two main functions today that we will understand about the buddhi is, the buddhi creates the focus of attention, dhyan. So the buddhi decides where you will focus your attention. And second is, the buddhi has willpower. So when our buddhi is well developed, then I can choose where I want to focus my attention on, and I can exercise my willpower and have determination. So this is the function of the buddhi. Now, the buddhi, if the buddhi is very powerful, then we can focus our attention on something that I want to instead of something that is attracting my attention. And when I do that, and when I'm able to focus my attention consciously on something that I want to focus it on, then my mind starts feeling that thing. And also my buddhi has willpower. So if I want to prolong that focus of attention for some time, I can do that, and then I can give the mind time to create a thought and then consequently a feeling and an attitude, and go into that whole groove of creating an experience, because I have the willpower and I can determine how long I want to focus on something. So this is an aspect of the buddhi. Now, when you become aware that you have a buddhi and your buddhi has this power, then this awareness itself makes you very powerful. When you become aware that you have a buddhi and that buddhi has that power to pay attention to whatever you want to pay attention to, and your buddhi has the willpower, then this knowledge, this awareness, this truth is a very powerful thing to know. And when you actually make this truth sit in you, that is, you the soul become aware of this truth, then you, in that process of being aware, you are actually empowering your buddhi. Okay? Now, This is something that we understood that yes, I have a mind, I have a buddhi, and I have sanskars or personality traits which I think define me today, right? But today I will tell you about the original qualities of the soul. Everybody says this is my nature and that is my nature. Yes? So, and we know our nature from experience. Like when I, yesterday some youth had called me up and then I asked him, what is your nature? So he said, I'm very lazy and I'm very difficult to please and I don't have any concentration. So I said, that's not a very good thing to know about yourself. So he said, yes, I am this and this and this. And he gave me a whole set of negative qualities. And then he said, this is my nature. So I told him, no, that's your habit. That's not your nature. That's your habit. So I said, what do you mean by habit and what does it mean by nature? So I told him that habit is sometimes defined as second nature. Yes, we call habit second nature. And why second nature? Because anything that we do for very long periods of time comes about to give us a feeling that this is who I am. But actually, that's only because we have done it over a long period of time and we experience it as our nature, but actually it's just a habit. So everything that we say is my nature today is most probably our habit. Yes? And why do we use the word habit and not nature? Because whatever is nature, whatever is my nature, will feel right, will feel good. I cannot be uncomfortable in my natural state. When you use the word natural, it implies comfort. Anybody who is uncomfortable in a state cannot say that this is my natural state, because if that was your natural state, there would be no tendency to shift from that natural state. Because whatever is natural must be the equilibrium, and equilibrium is defined as that state where you don't have any tendency to shift. But most of us are struggling with what we call our nature. And given a choice, given a chance, we would like to change it. So anything that we would like to change cannot be called our nature. So now, what is my nature? So according to the wisdom given by God, the soul, the qualities or the natural traits of the soul are seven in number. There are seven qualities of the soul: knowledge, purity, peace, love, happiness, bliss, and power. Knowledge, purity, peace, love, happiness, bliss, and power. These are the seven basic qualities of the soul. This is the nature of the soul. And if you have a good look at it, these are the qualities which, when experienced by the soul, they never want less of it. They never want to shift from that. For example, if you gave somebody love, they would always want more of it. Nobody says, I've had enough love today, I don't want love. Or nobody says that today has been very peaceful and now I want some peacelessness today. Nobody talks like that. Or nobody says, it's been a happy day, now I want to be a little unhappy. So Because these are the basic qualities of the soul. That's why we always want it, and we want it as much as we can have it. And this proves that these are my natural qualities. So when I am self-aware, it actually means I operate from the wisdom, from the awareness that I am not my context. I am a soul. I think, I create my feelings, and my nature is purity, peace, love, happiness, bliss, power, and knowledge. So if I have to respond to something, first I have to come into my awareness of my quality and then respond in accordance with my quality. So when we say living a life of self-awareness, it actually means always knowing who I am, what is my power, what is my quality, and coming into action from the viewpoint of that awareness. Not responding or not coming into action because of what is happening outside, because of what the quality of the situation outside is, but coming into action from a place where I'm anchored in my truth. When I know who I am, when I know that I create my feelings, I create my thoughts, and whatever I speak, however I behave, should and must be a product of who I am inside. And when we create this awareness that I am a peaceful, loveful, pure, blissful, powerful soul, and come into action from that point of awareness, then this is supposed to be a life led inside out, or this is a life led in self-awareness. Okay? Now, there is a belief system that we would like to touch upon today. Every soul today is not in its power. That is, although our original qualities are knowledge, purity, peace, love, happiness, bliss, and power, today the quotient of these seven qualities inside us is not very profound. If I asked you, what is your happiness quotient? Rate your happiness quotient on a scale of 1 to 10. If I put my question more clearly, what I am asking you is, how unconditionally happy can you be throughout the day on a scale of 1 to 10? Rate that.
Seven.
Okay. Anybody else?
Six.
Six. Okay. Now the important point to note in the question is unconditional. Okay. Now, when I was giving a class to a group earlier, I asked them, are you happy? And they said, yes, we are happy. And then I asked them, how happy are you? So they said, on a scale of 10, maybe 8, 9, somebody said 10 also. Then I asked them, what is the reason of your happiness? Why are you happy? So then there is, whenever we ask ourselves this question, why am I happy? Yes, I am happy. Today I am happy. Why am I happy? Because I have good health. Because the sun is shining outside. Because I got good breakfast to eat. Because circumstances around me are okay. Because people are behaving nicely to me. Because I recently got a promotion. Because my financial health is good. So these are the factors why we are happy. Now, if my happiness has a reason, then you must know that every reason has a season. And whenever the season will end, the reason will end. And then the happiness will also end. So when we say, I am happy because of this factor, then that means that that factor is crucial towards the feeling of happiness that I am experiencing. And if it is so, then yesterday we explored this question that nothing is unchangeable in life. So any external situation is bound to change sooner or later. And it would not be wrong to say that the very cause of your happiness will turn into the cause of your sorrow tomorrow. The very cause that makes you happy today will make you miserable tomorrow, because if you are happy because you have it, you will be miserable when you don't have it. Yes? So more often than not, the very reasons that make us happy today turn out to be reasons that make us very, very miserable tomorrow. And in life, it has been experienced that people who are experiencing very peak happiness today will become very miserable tomorrow, because that whole experience is founded on something that is external and changeable. There was once a lady who came to me, and she was in acute depression. And she shared with me that her husband was the governor of a state. And all her life, she enjoyed the privileges of being a governor's wife. So that was life. And she said, we had such a great life that we couldn't differentiate between day and night. Days were as gay and happy as nights. So it was a run-of-the-mill thing, and every day there were parties and people coming, visiting. It was festivity all through the year. And then she said, suddenly my husband died. And when my husband died, it seemed as if everything collapsed in an hour. And after that whole process of the funeral and everything, when people left, then she said, my very children started mistreating me for property. And then there were other factors also that came in, and we had to vacate the house that we had been enjoying the privilege of for years. And then misery started. And then she said, it's not like I'm living in some shabby apartment or something. I have a decent house today. I'm living in a 3-bedroom house, and there is a servant, and there is everything. And if I tell you, absolutely, there is no reason for me to feel depressed. But the thing is, I have enjoyed pleasures and privileges in such magnitude that this looks really bad to me. And this is why I'm very miserable. Although when somebody comes and visits me, they don't find anything wrong with my life today. And she told me, and then I asked her about her childhood, and she told me, I belong to a very humble background. My father was not a very rich man, and we lived in a 2-room house set all our life. But then slowly I got used to this way of living. And then today my house is bigger than where I started, but I'm very miserable. And there is no reason for me to feel miserable, but then I'm feeling this way and I can't come out of this depression. So this is what I want you to acknowledge, that if there are factors that that are actually propelling my journey, my internal experience from happy to very happy to that peak experience of joy, then the absence of those very factors will become the reason why I plunge into that state of depression. Okay, so this is what we have to understand, that if my happiness is conditional upon something, and then that thing, that reason will go on for some time, and when it will not be there, then we'll be miserable. Now, why do you think that we were not very miserable as children? Yes, when we were children, when we were 6, 7 years old or 8 years old, we did not need grades or accolades or appreciation or anything to be happy. We could be happy playing with sand and dust. Because we could, that was the potential that was there in us. And then we started conditioning ourselves to be happy based on our grades and degrees and accolades and appreciation and on how many people trust us and how many people believe in us and how many people give us company and how many people approve of us. And then this whole game started, and today we can't be happy even if one factor is missing. So because we have given up on our unconditional experience of happiness and taken to this whole happiness set based on so many conditions. Similarly with peace, we could feel peaceful just by ourselves. I remember when we were children, we could take some toys and talk to them and be with them and be very peaceful and happy at that time. And we did not need anything to make us feel peaceful. But today, we have conditioned ourselves to feel peaceful only when there's a music playing or when there's nobody around or when there is some kind of, we go to a hill station or a resort or we are with nature or this or that. Because we have become so distant from our nature, that's why we need external nature, external resources to feel peaceful. So, these seven qualities were basically our qualities, and we could experience them unconditionally. But what we did is, we made them conditional, we started experiencing them, or we were trained or we were conditioned to believe that you can only be happy when this happens, you can only be peaceful when this happens, you can only be blissful or joyful or you can feel powerful when these things happen. And then there is a law which got into operation, and that law says, if you don't use it, you lose it. If you don't use it, you lose it. So we had this capacity to be peaceful, happy, blissful, powerful, loveful, and then we slowly started not using our internal capacities and started taking the support of external factors to give us that feeling. And because of this conditioning, we completely gave upon even the possibility of experiencing this on our own. And when we stopped using them, then we slowly lost them. So this is the journey of the soul. Now, if I have lost it by not using them, how do I get them back? How do I get them back? By starting to use them. This is very, very simple. So if you are asking people to help you feel loved, or if you are asking nature to make you feel peaceful, or if you are asking your postpositions and labels to help you feel happy, stop doing that and start giving love instead. Start sharing happiness instead. Start giving peace in action instead. And when you start doing that, then you come back to your original state. So we became takers from givers, and now to come back to our original state of fullness, we again need to just do the opposite, that is start giving. So in this journey of self-awareness, I will share two steps with you today. First step is, in the morning, as soon as you get up, creating this self-awareness that I'm not this body, I'm a being of light sitting in the center of the forehead, and I am thinking, I am creating my feelings. I have a buddhi. The buddhi has a focus of attention. I withdraw my attention from where it is anchored right now and take it to myself and start seeing or appreciating the qualities I have within. That is, I start seeing myself as a peaceful, blissful, loveful, full soul. And when I start doing that, I create that self-awareness. And then during the day, as I move along the day, manifesting this in action. So whenever I meet somebody, I'm in a situation or I'm doing some work, I do that in self-awareness. That is, I do not get caught up in the energy that the other person is radiating, or I do not get caught up in the energy of the work that I am doing, or I do not get caught up in the energy of the environment and the circumstances I am operating in. I operate from self-awareness. That is, I put my peaceful, happy, blissful qualities to good use, and I fill my mind with those qualities and think peacefully, think lovingly, think happily in every situation, every second of the day. And when I do that, at the end of the day, my experience within shifts a great deal, and I do not feel the way I was feeling yesterday. Does that make sense? Yes? So first we have to create this, yes. So we have to first create this self-awareness about who I am and then operate inside out. And when I operate inside out, I will be using my energies of love, peace, purity, happiness, bliss and power more. And when I use them, they tend to grow. Okay, so first in the morning, I use the law of attention. So wherever attention goes, energy flows and that thing grows. So I pay my attention to my qualities and make them grow in the morning. And then I use them in such a manner during the day that I start to feel peaceful, loveful, happy, because these feelings will grow only when you put them to use in action. Yes? And associated with this is another thing, which is I do not take the support of people, places and things to make me feel happy, peaceful, loveful. So you are engaging, every one of us is engaging in pleasure-seeking activities these days. Yes, activities and engagements that give us these feelings of pleasure, and pleasure is a substitute for happiness and bad substitute which drains our energy. So we are taking resort to these pleasure-seeking activities. It could be drugs, it could be smoking, it could be drinking, it could be eating more than necessary, it could be watching content that stimulates the senses. So if I want to stay in self-awareness, then I need to stop using these to stimulate the feelings of happiness, peace, love. And I just need to create thoughts and feelings on my own. Because we have got used to creating thoughts and feelings of happiness and bliss and other things stimulated by our senses. So this is precisely what we have done as a substitute when we grew out of these feelings or when we were short of these feelings. So these practices are still there. We watch a lot of television, we watch a lot of internet, we watch a lot on the internet, and then we eat to stimulate our taste buds, we engage in sexual activity to stimulate our senses, we engage in watching content that stimulates us in this manner, we take resort to drugs and other intoxicants so that we can feel that pleasure inside. So all these things have to be given up for some time as an experiment so that we can focus on how to use my energy that is within and experience happiness by exhibiting it outside rather than taking it from outside as a stimulation and feeling it. Yes. And if we keep doing both, then we will reach nowhere because we will feel that it is my self-awareness that's giving me this feeling, but actually it could be just pleasure or just something else, okay? So we need to be very aware that it doesn't have to come from outside, it doesn't have to be induced or stimulated from outside. I have to stay in awareness, use my internal qualities and experience it, and that will create a habit wherein I will recognize that it is actually inside out and I can be happy, peaceful, loveful, blissful, come what may. And in keeping with the times, we are all very aware that times are changing suddenly. And maybe tomorrow and in some way or the other, this whole incident of the coronavirus was a waking up to our inner void. And when people stopped getting the supplies of food from restaurants and food delivery outlets, and then they stopped getting the entertainment that they used by going out for a walk or to pubs or discos or for shopping or anything, then you know we came to know or we were faced with this fact, although few recognize it, that the internal agitation that we are feeling is because of our dependence on these stimulants to feel happiness and joy inside. And tomorrow, if the internet is not available to you, then what do you do? So that is the biggest stimulant available right now. Or if somebody who is very used to smoking or alcohol and they don't get that supply, then what happens? So this is the call of time that we learn how to rely on our internal resources to experience a life of fulfillment and actually radiate them out rather than be dependent on external resources to create a feeling of fulfillment inside. And this is the awakening that the time, the call of time is actually asking us or pleading us to listen to. And if we listen to this and we actually try to take cognizance of our inner reserves, inner resources, and then start using them in action and start realizing that actually it is all inside out, then we will be able to face other episodes of this things that change suddenly in a very smooth and pleasurable manner. Got it? Because this is one episode, okay, this episode will end, but then something else will come up in the future, and then something else will come up. And we are living in a time when things outside will not be smooth. So let us cultivate our inner world in such a manner that we are not afraid of the external changing, or the possibility of external change doesn't make us fearful and insecure. All right, let's meditate for a few seconds, that is, create this sense of self-awareness. Sit straight. Pay your attention to your breath for a few seconds. Just observe your breathing. And as you observe your breath, your body starts to relax. Now slowly unplug your attention from wherever it is scattered right now and bring it to the center of the forehead. And with your buddhi, become aware that you are just a being of light, distinct from this body made of five elements of nature. Appreciate your existence, your presence in the center of the forehead. I am a small star, a being of light, distinct from the five elements of nature which comprise the body. I am light, made of light. My energy is that of peace. The light of peace shines through me. See yourself shining peacefully in the center of the forehead. This is me. This is my form. This is my energy. Peace is who I am. Peace is my nature. Peace is what I radiate. Peace is what I experience. In this moment, as my attention is plugged into myself, I am aware of nothing but just the peace contained within me. Spend a few seconds in this awareness. Om Shanti. So let's meet tomorrow at 7:30 a.m. and try to use this quality of peace in your actions today, and let me know your experience. Om Shanti.